The irony that when you look up Blender noise filter, everything that comes up is about denoising, and I'm over here like, more noise, please. Hello, Sophie here. So the idea behind adding a noise filter is to give a digital artwork, especially one that uses a lot more solid blocks of color rather than detailed rendering, to give it a bit of grain, imperfections, and texture. I've heard it described as giving a digital piece a more traditional feel. We'll start by using a drawing program to make a noise filter. I'll be using Krita for this video, but this should be a standard thing that all drawing software can do. So I'll create a new file, have it as just a large square, and then I can just go up into Filter, Other, Random Noise. And so we just have random pixels. If I zoom in and out, you can see. And so I won't play around too much with the settings, but as you'll see at the end of this video, it is very easy to switch out different images. So if ever you did want to play around with the levels, the opacity, the color, and then try out different options, it is very easy to do that with this method. And so all I want to do is duplicate this layer and then select the first one, right-click, and convert it to a transparency mask. Transparency masks are grayscale images in which black is fully transparent and white is fully opaque. You could, for example, take an image, create a transparency mask, and with a black brush, remove the background from your image. And one huge advantage that this has over just erasing the background from the image itself is that you can always add back in previously erased areas with a white brush. So by duplicating our image and converting it into a transparency mask for itself, now the white areas of the image are fully opaque and the dark areas are transparent. But we want the opposite. You just want to select our transparency mask, and then in Krita, go into Filter, Adjust, Invert. Now we have the noise filter we created, but the white areas are fully transparent and they get more opaque as they get darker. This is super useful for turning JPEGs into transparent PNGs, and I use this especially when I made my grease pencil ink brushes. This could also work really well if you had an image that had a dark subject over a light background and you wanted to just remove the background completely. All you would need to do is duplicate your object, desaturate it, and then use the levels to get it down as close to white and black as possible, where the white is the background and the black is your subject. And then if you just converted this into a transparency mask and then inverted it, and it is that easy to remove a background from an image when the subject is dark enough and the background light enough. And that's just a bit of fun with masks. But back to our noise filter. So now all we want to do is to export our noise filter image as a transparent PNG. So I'll be using this piece to demonstrate the effect of the noise filter. So select the grease pencil object you've been working in and make a new layer at the top of your layer list. And in relations, you want to parent this to your camera. Then make a new material. And I like to make it both a stroke and a fill so that I can see the outline of the shape when I draw it. Then, in 3D space, place your 3D cursor close to the camera, closer than any other grease pencil element in your scene. I like to look at my scene from the side and use Shift right click to place the 3D cursor. If ever your 3D cursor is not visible, which by default it isn't, when you open a new 2D animation workspace, you can just go into the overlays and turn it on here. Then look through your camera and go into draw mode. And we want to set the stroke placement to 3D cursor and the drawing plane to view. And then just outline your rendered image. Now, in the Materials Properties tab, change the fill style from solid to texture, and then select Open and choose your noise image from your documents. And so in order to see it, we need to be in either Material Preview mode or Render View mode. So we'll look at these image texture options a bit later, but for now, let's just drop the blend to 0 to see our texture as it is, and then go into Layers, and let's play around with some of the blend options. So I was having trouble actually seeing the grain of the noise filter, and so I just went back into the fill and raised the scale so I could see them a bit more. And so clearly some of the blend mode options are more subtle than others, and I think it really depends on the specific piece. I'm not sure when multiply would ever apply, but maybe depending on the image for the fill. For this piece, I think I would go with add. And then of course, we can lower the opacity of this layer to lower the intensity of the effect. But what if I wanted to raise the intensity? Yeah, I mean, duplicating the layer is a pretty effective way to amplify the effect. Would probably go with that. So now, because our noise layer is parented to our camera, this means that as we rotate around our world, the noise is applied to all of it. And as I was doing this, the thought occurred to me that it was a little off that the noise was just kind of still, when I typically like having all kinds of subtle movements in my pieces, largely thanks to Grease Pencil's noise modifier. And so to very easily give the noise modifier a bit of life, we can go to the start of our animation, and then in the materials properties, we can keyframe one or both of the image texture's location values, and then go to the end of our animation, and then we can raise them both just by pressing down on one of them, dragging down so we access both of them, and then sliding left or right, and then keyframe both of these. And then just so it's a constant movement, I like to go into the dope sheet timeline, select the two keyframes, right click, and in interpolation mode, select linear. So this creates kind of like a static effect, which I think is really interesting. From testing out different location values, if you give it a really low value, then it is pretty obvious that it's just an image sliding across the screen and it doesn't look great. But you pretty quickly reach this threshold above which it all kind of just looks the same. It just looks like staticky. Kind of looks like snow falling. Again, this is definitely a look, and it may not be right for every piece, but it's always great to have options. Now, let's say we want to add screen tones to a Grease Pencil artwork, be it 2D or 3D. I'll use this 3D piece just to show you the potential here. So I'll link in the description some free halftone screen tone textures that I found, as well as Dante's brush and texture pack. This would really come in handy for this for sure. But I actually just discovered that you can create halftones in Krita. So I'll undo all of this. And then it seemed to only want to work if I started with a black layer. And then if you go into Filter, Artistic, Halftone, you get white dots on black. Not what I'm here for. Oh, that hurts your eyes. If you go into post-processing and invert, and then I got really nice effects when I lowered the hardness and I got larger circles. All right, so I'll repeat the steps for the transparency mask because I want it to be a transparent PNG image and export it as a PNG. And so now, switching out different noise images or to just try out different textures completely, it's as simple as going into the materials and just changing the image that you have selected. If you have a screen tone or a texture that has some kind of gradient, then it can definitely be useful to modify the location value with these settings, depending on where you want the gradient to start and end, and also how big or small you want the gradient to be. And then another really cool thing that we can do with these image textures is that by raising the blend value to 1, this allows us to use vertex paint on our texture. And so I could go into vertex paint mode and make the screen tones any color that I want. And yes, as you can see, if I lower the blend back down to 0, it's just black, but at 1, it can be any color that we want. And then if I play around with the blend options again, ooh. But something to note about screen tones, rarely are they applied evenly over the whole piece. They're typically used in very specific areas, and so we can actually do this with layer masks. So for my first screen tone layer, I can check on the masks option. And so if I were to select the layer that contains the body of my character, we can see that now the screen tones are just contained to her face and her skin, and it's interesting. But we can actually invert this mask with this button so that the screen tone affects every area of the piece except her skin. And so with this combination of masking it to certain areas and invert masking it away from other areas, you really can combine all kinds of different colored screen tones with different blend options, and have them affect all kinds of different areas in your piece. And what's incredibly cool about masking in 3D space with 3D grease pencil objects is that even as I rotate around my 3D scene, the screen tones will stay either within the mask or away from the inverted mask. So that will be it for this video. I hope that this has inspired you to add some cool effects to your pieces. If you want to see more of my works in progress, you can follow me. I'm at Sophie Jantek on all of the social medias. Thank you so much for being here and for all of your support. Take care. Bye.